will have such a serious challenges to the global trade. And now it's a reality, and we strongly feel that while India's growth is something important for us, but global growth is also as important. And in a way, global growth brings in benefit to all the countries, maybe in different forms, in different dimensions. But this is an important issue. And therefore, while we face these challenges globally, look at what India is doing. While all the countries in the world are struggling, and I'm just telling you as early as yesterday, day before yesterday, because yesterday landed, that all the G20 countries are really concerned about their own growth and also linked to it the global growth. And in that context, in that background, last quarter, India grew by 8.3%. And we are very sure that in the next 7 to 8 years' time, India should touch a $5 trillion output GDP. And to do that, as a Minister of Commerce and Industry, we have worked out a study. 20% of the GDP should come from industry. That's $1 trillion. 20% will come from industry. 60% will come from services. That's $3 trillion. And $1 trillion will come from agriculture and related activities. And to do this, we are working out on an even sub-sectoral study. In industry, we already finalized the new industrial policy for the government, for the country. And this new industrial policy is dealing with quite a few issues related to industry. How to reduce and, if possible, remove all the regulations. How to modernize the existing industry, but more importantly, how to bring in new industry. Because you are all more knowledgeable than me, that two companies recently reached a $1 trillion market cap. And they were the first to reach a $1 trillion market cap in the history of the world. But interestingly, at the same time, around a little earlier, an Indian company reached 100 billion market cap. And all the three companies are in such businesses which were not so prevalent or not so popular about a few decades ago. And the companies which are in business for more than a century could never reach even half of that market cap. So what does it mean? That those new industries are going to be driving the future. So we are focusing on modernizing the existing businesses, existing industry, because India is still the sixth largest manufacturing country in the world, so we must to make sure that that becomes relevant, modernized. But second part, to get in the best of the new industries coming in. And therefore we identified 7-8 such sectors which we feel would be driving the growth of the future. And we are focusing on them as well. While we do that, it will be very imperative that we become part of global supply chains, global value chains. Because shape of manufacturing, nature of manufacturing has changed over a period of time. Now nobody makes end-to-end product in one place. A good part of the supply chain happens in different parts of the world. And we have an experience of doing that. In case of auto component, India has done extremely well in being part of that global supply chain. Even in generics, we are already there. And we have identified some other sectors in which we'll be taking this route of linking India's economy to global supply chains, and we'll try to work on that. So this is a part of an industry which we like to modernize, bring a new industry to get into this 20%, which has said $1 trillion of output. And we discussed with all the industry associations and industry bodies, and actually based on that, even what could be coming into this $1 trillion has been worked out. The services, India is already a dominant economy in services, and India's contribution, that India's services contribute significantly to India's GDP. But we identified 12 champion sectors which we feel will result into more services growth domestically as well as globally. We already have $20 billion of portfolio for service exports, and would like to even bring in the more of services into that. So right now we are working out on a strategy of, while 12 champion sectors have been identified and a detailed working plan has been prepared, how to make these 12 champion sectors boost this economy. In that, as well as for merchandise exports, incidentally, India's merchandise export were declining, and first time in last six years, the highest rate growth, the rate of growth in exports of merchandise we achieved, and in the last few months our exports are growing, and I'm very sure that we'll, this year, end of this current fiscal, we'll definitely have the highest ever exports in India's history, so we'll register that. But that means that we have to cover even more ground, because we want to make sure that our strategy for export will help both our external sector as well as domestic economy. And to do that, we are studying different geographies and finding out where could India export more. So we have done that market research for the first time and identified the areas in which India has a comparative advantage, and therefore we could export more to that particular country. So which is the product and which is that country we can export? So we have worked out a matrix and we are aggressively marketing it. In fact, in Africa, for example, India's export is only 8%. Whereas India has invested a lot geopolitically, geoeconomically in Africa for a number of years, maybe few decades. So there's already goodwill, receptivity, acceptability to India coming there. And now we are organizing very important regional meetings with them. We've already done Southern Africa, Eastern Africa. I'll be doing it Eastern, Western Africa, in which we call all the surrounding countries with top business leaders, ministers, everybody, and we are working out with them as to how we can export more to them. We have done that with Latin America. I've already covered Central America as well as other parts of Southern America, and we are already working on that as well. Central Asia, same strategy we are working. So I'm working on ASEAN. We have a long-standing relationship anyway, and we are working. We just recently also working on RCEP, which is going to be one of the biggest trade deal, and we have already clearly said that India will be part of it, and we have already said that we would like to make sure that services become a key component of negotiations on this. The RCEP is for economic partnership, and as you will agree, economic partnership is not just trade partnership. It goes beyond trade, so services also have to come in along with merchandise to make that happen, and we are aggressively working on that. And we already proposed to EU that we like to also have a very advanced stage of negotiations with them, because in 2013, after 16 rounds, there was no progress. So we are trying to work on export as also one of the key components of the strategy, in which merchandise and services both will be key components. Because clearly, the incremental exports will come more from services. And therefore, to make that happen, we are gearing up, and for both, we are coming out with standards so that very clearly export can be happening both for services as well as merchandise and acceptable to the countries where we'll be actually exporting it. As you know, we have very good trade relations with US, and we are definitely working towards making it better. We feel very strongly that while we grow in terms of growth, we must also ensure that this entire process becomes extremely transparent. And therefore, transparency is going to be a driving force for policy making as well as implementation. You'll be happy to know that we launched a very interesting program called GEM, Global E-Marketplace. And today, the governments, federal as well as state, and now we are trying to go even to the sub-state level governments, regional, the district governments, they will be buying and they are buying through this electronic portal. And this has been brought in so much of transparency that it is not even, could have been imagined only about 2 years ago. This has resulted in the vendors getting payment in time, and sometimes if there is a default, and there has not been so far, but if there is, the vendor will get the payment within 3 weeks, and if doesn't get it, then that company or that government organization which actually was supposed to make the payment will be taken it out of it. And there is an incentive for them to remain there because they are getting almost 20-25% discount on many products. Because that money which was going elsewhere is now becoming a part of cost and reducing cost. So transparency is going to be a very important component of all these activities that we are doing. We are also working on industrial estate, rather industry parks. 3 main corridors are being built, and we are actually talking to countries. I was in Russia recently. Russians are very keen to invest, so are Japanese, so are Koreans. We had almost 100 Koreans, owner CEO level people were in India recently. Maybe more than 150 Japanese, same level people came to India. And on the 4th, we are getting Russians, as many numbers to make that happen. And I've not so many countries. So each of these countries is interested to make investment. So we have said that part of this industrial parks we'd like to reserve for you so that we can develop infrastructure which befits your requirement. And then for part of that investment that will be made will be also made in such a way that we decide that what type of product and which country will make that happen in there. So we are actually working on that. And therefore, many countries are now looking at India to invest in a big way. Incidentally, in the first 3 months, our FDI has gone up by more than 20%. So therefore, we are actually looking at an opportunity in which how to get foreign investment to supplement the domestic savings rate which is improving, and therefore the investment rate in India, how should rise more. Only yesterday, there were super funds from Australia who met me. It was a follow-up visit because I had met them in Australia. Little earlier, the Canadian pension fund met us. We are very clearly telling them that in case of Australia, the size of pension fund is more than the GDP. So obviously they must invest outside because the size of GDP itself, the propensity to absorb it is not there. And there is no better opportunity for their investment than in India, number one, because as I said, we are growing and we'll be 5 trillion and maybe 10 trillion in 15 years' time. At the same time, the infrastructure investment that will go into India will be probably one of the highest in the world. And to do that, we need such resources like pension fund resources, which are long maturity. And for the pension fund, it meets perfectly because they also need to invest into such paper, which will be actually not immediately because they don't need those money immediately. Therefore, we are working on that, and a lot of companies are also keen to, and countries, we need to work with us on that. Also, we are very keen and we are working on a very comprehensive strategy. I'll just mention one sector to bring that point to your notice. Aviation sector. I'm also Minister of Aviation, so I'm mentioning it. India's aviation sector has been growing at 20%. The fastest growing aviation sector in the world. And to sustain that, we need to put in a lot of things into place. We already announced we'll make 100 new airports in the next 10 to 12 years' time with an investment of $65 billion. But in addition to that, India would need to buy about 1,000 aeroplanes, because minimum. And that's not government is going to buy because this is completely deregulated, private sector dominated industry. And in that, we also coming out with a policy. If anybody would like to manufacture aircraft in India, that's what we like to encourage under the Make in India program. How that can happen over a period of time. What type of ecosystem we need to develop. what kind of policy support we need to provide to them. Sorry, talk to Airbus and Boeing, the main two major companies, as well as others, how they can come and make that happen in India. Other interesting part of this sector is the drones. And we feel that drones are going to be dominating not only the skies, but the economy as well. And therefore, we already come out with a policy for making of drones in India as well as use of drones in India. A proper regulation has been put in place in a very forward-looking manner. So this is one sector which will be growing fast. And to do that, we are also coming out with a new policy for air cargo policy. Because when we talk about passenger movement, we just said 20% is the highest that we are recording. But India, imagine the cargo movement that will happen in India. Because 5 billion or 10 billion numbers would need that much of output, that much of people movement, that much of so many services movement, so a lot of service movement will happen. And therefore, air cargo policy will be announced soon. And also, Prime Minister has created a department called Logistics for the first time in India. And in fact, this is part of my ministry, in Commerce Ministry. So there we are coming out with the logistic policy. We already be launching logistic portal to bring in the best benefits to the aggregators and others. But we are also coming out with how do we develop a logistic to digitalize it fully and working on a digital platform to make it happen. And that work has already started. We are also working with some of the multilateral agencies, taking the help in terms of getting ideas and actually making this as an integrated development of cargo as well as complete development of the entire logistic. And to do that, there are many areas have been identified, many sectors have been identified. How do you make sure that logistic developed in India would cater to the requirement of domestic economy as well as support the increasing ambition of India to be part of a global economy? And therefore, that is also being worked on. I am sure there are many areas in which we are still making progress. One is infrastructure, as I said, and in railways, for example, I was the Minister of Railways till recently. The first 70 years, the money that was invested in the railways, we invested almost the same in the first 3 years of this government. I presented a budget to the parliament, and that was a time when there was a separate railway budget which should be presented to the parliament. Now we don't no longer do that, and rightly so. But I had prepared a $144 billion plan for investment to railways in the first 5 years. And that was a very ambitious plan and almost getting implemented. And we are also at the same time making structural changes in many areas in railways, including bringing complete transparency, which I said should be the hallmark of all our activities. And therefore, even infrastructure, we are making investments, whether it's roads or ports or any other area. And I can see very clearly, therefore, coming to this point, is the opportunity of growth. That India, at macro level, will grow. Sectorally, you can see there will be a growth. And to be part of this, to be part of this growth journey, I think we'll be very happy to have the global community participating in it. And therefore, we always look out for opportunities to find out where is any issue that can actually be addressed through policy framework. So we have built many policy changes in FDI, particularly in the last few months. And now, virtually for most of the sectors, FDI is allowed in without much of a restriction, including it's actually automatic route. So for the big FDI deal took place recently, even the government was informed, probably through the newspapers, because it was automatic route. And therefore, we are encouraging that to happen, and therefore we very strongly feel that India's growth will be fueled by many engines. One is the investment, domestic as well as foreign. Second will be the consumption, because as you will see, India's middle class rising, people like to spend more. One good example is the aviation. How is the aviation sector growing? It's people want to be traveling more by aeroplanes. And this has always been a desire of every individual when he was a child, that I must travel by the plane which I can see from the ground. I must be in the air and watching the ground from there, not watching the aircraft from the ground. And that is what is happening in reality. Many people are actually participating in this. So you will see more and more people spending, and that consumption and spending will also drive the growth. Infrastructure, as we create, drives the growth, because that spending that goes into infrastructure also spurs growth. But infrastructure once created also facilitates higher growth. And that will be another engine of growth that will happen over a period of time. And agriculture, which Prime Minister is now very focused on, wants to double the farmers' income in the next 5 years' time. And a lot of strategies have been put in place. How to link technology to the field, that's the pre-sowing area. And how do you make sure that when we plant something and it is created, how do you actually reach it to the market? So a lot of farm-to-market strategies also put in place, and technology farm strategies also are putting in place. Including one of the key areas which was neglected is the soil itself. Because as you know, the soil is the cause of fertility of land. If the land itself can produce food or any agriculture, then desert should be the right place to grow it, because there is plenty of land available. But it's a topsoil that actually decides how much more you will produce. And we have not really paid any attention to the topsoil for a long time, because we are using nitrogenous fertilizers more than potash and phosphatic fertilizers. So that NPK ratio, which is so important, was ignored. Now soil cards are made, soil health cards are made, and based on that we are doing it. So we'll see even agriculture growing, and incidentally, already as my ministry, we are preparing agriculture export policy, already finalized and we'll be announcing soon. Because India this year will be producing agriculture and horticulture put together almost 600 million tons. So therefore we'll have to find out a strategy to linking to the global markets. And there are countries which are interested. In fact, on the 15th October, the Abu Dhabi Investment Authority chair, who is he's coming to India, we are having a high-level task force meeting, which I chair from Indian side. And we are thinking about many areas, and they want to invest large amount of money in India. That's the largest sovereign wealth fund. In that, we are one of the areas that we are considering, how to export agriculture products into the Middle East and other areas. I did the same thing when I was in Argentina. We had a very interesting discussion with the Saudi minister, who's also interested in many areas. So why I'm saying this is that growth in agriculture in itself will be a good news for economic growth, but also the growth in agriculture will bring in rural incomes, and that rural income again will be the cause of growth. So many areas, many engines, as I said, you'll be seeing the growth coming into India. So India's growth is a reality. Now comes the opportunity, and that is for you, great investors, have to choose, pick and choose, because opportunities are plenty. And therefore, sometimes, and many times it happens, that we feel, oh, this is a challenge. But then there is another person who says, oh, there is a challenge, you said yes. So that's why you are leaving, thank you very much, because I want to go in and take that opportunity, because challenge is an opportunity for me. So it all depends upon how do you convert a challenge into opportunity. And any perfect market, you'll always see less opportunities. Any market which is already settled, will see less opportunity. India is a growing market. India is a market which is going to be changing so dramatically that one cannot even imagine. For example, somebody had said only 5 years ago that we'll see such a growth in aviation, nobody would have ever believed it. But it's a reality. And that is why it's going to happen in the next few years' time. And we really look forward that you all should be also our partners into this growth that is going to be there in India for many reasons, as I mentioned. And I really request you to please tell us, in case you feel that something more we can do to make that growth faster, better, and also quicker, so we can all take part into that. And we will be very happy, therefore, to work with all of you. I once again thank JP Morgan for bringing in such a distinguished group of people to India, to New Delhi. And I can only tell you one thing, that JP Morgan is no longer, we consider, the foreign bank. We think it's part of the India growth story. And I think as they have become part of India growth story, I would feel all of you must become equally partners and be part of that growth story as well, because it's always mutually beneficial. The growth happens because of your participation. Growth benefits us, but also benefits the investor. And therefore, it's always the issue of win-win situation, and we'll try to build up this win-win partnership. So I really wish you all the best. I congratulate all the participants for choosing India as your place of interest. I'm sure you'll make it, not just interest, but also investment. So thank you very much for that. I had to attend a cabinet meeting, that's why I was constantly looking at my watch. And I really thank you for giving me this opportunity of talking to such a distinguished people. Thank you very much.